Welcome to the final episode in the Radio Design 101 series. Today we're going to finish the receiver and try it out. We are the champions. If you've watched previous episodes in this series, you know that what we're working towards is designing and building an FM broadcast band receiver. We started with background material for Project 1, which is the design and construction of a low-noise amp with associated filters. Then we went on to Project 2, where we found that if we take the amplifier and add some feedback, we can actually generate an oscillator. And we use that as a local oscillator in Project 3 to mix down, i.e. convert, the frequencies at the antenna to a lower frequency where it's easier to filter them better and to amplify them. Today, we're going to finish that off by amplifying them more, a lot more, and then demodulating them to get recovered audio. But in keeping with this course being general, we could also apply the same techniques to get frequency shift keying outputs from a digital system. In the university course from which this material is derived, students put together their radios at the end of the semester. And if they're lucky, it doesn't work the first time, and that's not unusual for a complex engineering job. The reason I say that that happens if they're lucky is because then they'll go into debugging, where a lot of actual additional learning takes place, and eventually we get success. So let's get started. Let's see where we've been and where we're going. We'll start off looking at the super heterodyne receiver architecture to review how that works. And then we'll go into the new circuits today, which is an IF limiting amplifier and a quadrature FM demod. After we've got that done, we'll put it all together and demonstrate it. And we'll finish up by looking at some of the chips that we've used in the class in the past and at some more highly integrated designs. As we've discussed in this series, bandpass filters are critical to radio design. Virtually all radio architectures start with some kind of a pre-select filter to filter out things that are not within the band of signals that we're interested in. Here, in this lower graph, the frequency is on the horizontal axis and amplitude on the vertical, and we're showing a spectrum that might be coming in from an antenna. The desired band, in our case the FM broadcast band, is here, and the desired signal is this little tiny one right there. But there's tons of other signals out there. And the job of the pre-select filter is to eliminate as many of those as possible, especially like these strong ones over here, before they hit the low noise amplifier. And so if this filter is doing its job, it does that, and in fact it gets rid of these lower frequency ones and the higher frequency ones. The ones that are right here, some of those got through, so you can see a little bit of that. But that's okay, because there's another filter after that before the mixer called the image filter, and by that time we've gotten rid of everything except the desired broadcast band. The next step in the signal processing is going through the mixer, where we take a local oscillator and we convert this band of signals down to, in this case, a lower frequency. And you can see that here in this top right-hand graph, where the entire signal spectrum has been shifted down to a much lower frequency than it was before. If you've seen the previous episode on mixers, we actually showed some of this in real life using the tiny spectrum analyzer. And we also saw some of the local oscillator feed-through and some of the RF feed-through and the up-converted spectrum, none of which we're going to use. The only thing we care about is this down-converted band here. And the next thing that happens is we go through an IF filter, which I sometimes call a channel select filter because that's really what its job is. It takes this spectrum at the top here and converts it to this spectrum, where we've eliminated all but one channel in the FM broadcast band. At least that's how it's supposed to work. If there are nearby signals, some of those might come through a little bit, and you may also see some of the higher frequency signals coming through. But that's okay, because the IF amps, which is subject to today, are high gain, but they're also low pass. They're not going to amplify these signals. So they're going to take the desired signal and bump it up, as you can see over here on the right. But because these amplifiers are generally low pass and response, they don't amplify the higher frequency stuff. So now we've really selected out just the desired signal, plus some noise, perhaps. How much noise? Well, that depends on how close to the noise floor the input signal was at the antenna, and how good we did our low noise amplifier and the overall chain. Here, it's a good signal to noise ratio, definitely. Enough to go into the demodulator. Or in a lot of modern radios, we might go directly into an analog to digital converter at this point. In our design, we're just going to have a demod, and then we'll take the audio output that comes from that and feed it to an audio amp and listen to it on the speaker. But before we do all of that, we've got to figure out how to design these pieces. And we'll start off by looking at the IF amplifier. And the question is, how much gain do we need? To figure that out, we've got to look at the signal levels that may be coming in from the antenna. Here, I've labeled those as minus 110 to minus 10 dBm. That's a broad range of signal levels, but this is typical for real-world radios. If the antenna used is a 50-ohm antenna, then these power levels convert to these voltage levels. So we're talking about something from 0.7 microvolts, or 700 nanovolts, up to 70 millivolts. Now, obviously, the weakest signal, 0.7 microvolts, is going to determine how much gain we ultimately need. Now, we already have some gain. We have 20 dB in the low noise amplifier. And if we did our mixer well, we've got about 10 dB in the down conversion. The question is, how much gain do we need here in the IF amp? And the answer can be found by considering how much signal level needs to go into the demod. That depends on the particular circuit design. But in our case, we need somewhere between 100 and 500 millivolts. Now, also note that I've signaled this is at 300 ohms. So by the time we're coming out of the mixer and going through this IF filter, we're not focused on 50 ohms anymore. In fact, our filters are 300 ohm filters. And I designed the IF amp to work in that range too, so we could put another filter here if we wanted in between these two amplifiers. And the answer to how much gain we need in the IF amp is down here at the bottom in this equation. Overall, we need a gain of about 100 dB from the antenna to the DMOD input. And you can compute that as shown here. But we don't need that much in the IF amp because we already have some gain preceding it. And in addition, we have an impedance step up from 50 to 300 ohms. And so there are some adjustments. So we subtract off the total of 30 dB of gain ahead of the IF amp. And we also adjust for that impedance transformation from 50 to 300 ohms that happens over here. The end result is we're going to need about 65 dB of gain. Before we go on to how we're going to get that, let's come back to the antenna and note that we've got about 100 dB of range here. Signals could be up to 70 millivolts at the antenna, and then we would have way too much gain here. What happens instead depends on the particular modulation you're using. In an FM receiver, what we're going to do is we're going to let these amplifiers limit. We're going to let them clip, as we'll see, so that for very strong signals, they'll basically be putting out square waves into the demodulator. But that's okay, because this is frequency modulation, and we have the audio information in the changes in frequency, which are maintained even in a square wave envelope. If this were instead an AM receiver or a single sideband receiver or a complicated QAM digital receiver, we may need what's called automatic gain control. So we may apply some gain control to this LNA and even to the mixer, but definitely to the IF amplifiers so that at the input to the demodulator, we never clip. We don't lose the amplitude information. But we don't have to deal with that level of complexity here because we're doing FM. So what we need is an IF limiting amplifier. And here's my most recent design for that. I did it in two stages. So we've got about 20, 30 dB of gain in the first stage and 30 or 40 dB of gain in the second stage. And this design is based on theory that we've covered in previous episodes. So I'm not going to go over everything in detail here, but I will walk us through it. We have our input signal over here on the left. Let's not worry about its amplitude right now. It comes in to the base of this transistor. There's another one up here. This is, you probably recognize, a cascode design. At the top, we have an LC resonant circuit that provides some filtering. So this is an RF amplifier made with the cascode configuration. The output of that stage goes into the second stage, which is also a cascode amp, with a tuned LC output stage. And finally, what's this? Well, that's a common collector amplifier design, also known as an emitter follower, whose gain, voltage gain, is 1 from here to here, but its output impedance is low, so it can drive a low impedance load. This is all powered off a 5-volt supply, and in our actual construction, we should have a bypass capacitor on this power supply rail from here to ground. But for a simulation, that doesn't matter because this 5-volt supply is perfect and provides an AC ground at this point. Note that these transistors in this simulation are generic, and they've labeled something here 100 amps per amp. That's just the beta of the transistor is assumed to be 100. But a good design will not rely on that, and I didn't rely on that in this design. This schematic and the simulation results that we'll look at in a second are done using a free version of National Instruments Multisim Live, which is something you can just go out and search for, and you can get access to it. It's a web-based simulation tool. Very cool. But, of course, the free version doesn't have every transistor in it, and so you might want to pay for it if you want more detailed models. But for our purposes here, this is a 10.7 megahertz amplifier. I wasn't worried about that. The results are shown over here, going from 100 kHz up to 1 GHz. 10 MHz, or 10.7, is right about here, and that's where it peaks, and the magnitude is the green curve, and it looks like it's peaking at close to 70 dB of gain. That's the final output. The blue line is the intermediate output. That's over here. So there's less gain up to that point. But this is a small signal AC analysis, and so it's not going to show any of the limiting that takes place. For that, we need to look at a transient analysis, which is shown here. The left-hand graph is for a 40 microvolt input signal amplitude. And again, the blue line is the intermediate node right here between the two stages, and the green line is the final output. Notice that at 40 microvolt input level, even the final output does not limit. It's still a sine wave. But if we go nuts and bump that up to 1 volt, which could come out of a mixer or something, you get limiting on both the blue and the green. It looks like the final output amplitude ranges from about 3.3 volts up to about 4.8 volts. So that's about 1.5 volts peak to peak, maybe a little bit more than we were talking about going into our DMOD, but not bad. So when I built this up, I did only the second stage because I wanted to keep my life a little bit simple. On the right-hand side, we can see the construction. We have UFL connectors over here on the left at the input and at the right on the output. And the cascode transistors, there's one here, and there's one under this giant inductor. This is the 20 microhenry inductor. It was 10 microhenry in the previous one, but I didn't have a 10, so I used a 20, and I adjusted C4 for that. Q3 is this transistor right here. And in the basic design, there is a voltage divider at the output, R5 and R10. That divide the signal down to about a third of what the signal swing is here. So instead of a volt and a half peak to peak, down to about 500 millivolts peak to peak. But that's not good for testing with the VNA because it's going to load this output with 50 ohms, and so this 500 ohms is going to become something less than 50. So for the testing, we bypassed this upper resistor. And here is that testing. We used our nano VNA, with port 1 feeding the input and the output going to port 2, but not without attenuators, because this is an amplifier with a lot of gain. This VNA puts out about 0 dBm. So we started off with 30 dB attenuator on port 1, and then the output we fed through a 10 dB attenuator to protect the VNA. We then calibrated the VNA with those in place by taking a cable from here to here, did the calibration, and we measured 32 dB of gain at 10.7 MHz, as shown here. But that's less gain than we were expecting based on our simulation. And in addition to that, we don't see the peak that we did in the sim. And that's because we have limiting going on in this amp. So to get it to stop limiting, we added a second attenuator, another 20 dB on port 1, so that what goes into the amplifier is now minus 50 dBm or so. We did not recalibrate because that would be a very weak signal to do the cal with, so we just have to visually adjust. Whatever we see on the curves over here, we add 20 dB to that. So we actually have a gain of 40 dB at 10 MHz. Interestingly, it peaks at 6 MHz, so clearly we need to do some tweaking. Something is a little off in the sim. Remember, those models were not exact models for the transistors we were using. But 40 dB is not bad. Remember, we've got 30 dB ahead of that. In addition, we've got another 10 dB due to the impedance conversion. So we've got a total of about 80 dB from the antenna to the DMOD. And remember, our signals vary a lot in amplitude. So we may not be able to get this real weak one here. We'll certainly be able to get this strong one and probably get a number of other reasonably strong ones in the band. So for that reason, I decided to press ahead and do the quadrature FM DMOD next so we can get this radio working. We can always come back and improve it later. So here's what a quadrature DMOD is and how it works. I'm calling this a classic FM quadrature subsystem because I've went ahead and included the limiting amplifier in this diagram. The DMOD starts right here, but it's important for this design to have a limited waveform coming in with no amplitude changes on it. It's kind of a square wave at this point, but that doesn't really matter because as we saw in the mixer episode, we end up mixing with a square wave anyway, so it doesn't matter what's going in here. And when it goes through this phase shifter, we'll see it turns into a sine wave. So I'm drawing this with cosines everywhere. Just makes the math easier. So what did we learn about mixers in the previous episode? We learned that if you have two cosines coming in, one at the RF port and one at the LO port, then we get a cosine at the output of the mixer at the difference of the two input frequencies. Also at the sum, but we're going to have a low-pass filter, so we'll forget about that. Now, what's the difference of the two frequencies? Well, this is FIF. Now, remember, this is varying in frequency because it's FM modulated. But at any instant in time, this cosine is at FIF. This one is also. The only difference here is that we've shifted the phase of this one coming into the bottom of the mixer. So the two frequencies are equal, so we're going to get zero frequency output. But when you go through the math, like we did in the last episode, you'll find out that you get the difference of this whole term here and this whole term here, and the difference is just theta, whatever phase shift was applied. So the output is VC cosine theta. VC is just the amplitude of it. Remember, these are fixed amplitudes here, so this is some fixed amplitude. The information is contained in this cosine theta, which is going to vary as the frequency FIF is varying. Remember, it's moving back and forth, lower to higher, to represent the modulation. Now, to understand what happens next, we need to talk about how the phase angle varies with frequency based on this phase shifter network. And we try to design the phase shifter network so it does something like shown here. At low frequencies, we have 180 degrees of phase shift through here. At high frequencies, we have 0 degrees of phase shift. More importantly, at the center frequency, exactly 10.7 MHz in our case, we have 90 degrees. What's the cosine of 90 degrees? Well, here's a cosine function. Sorry about the wiggles in it. But at 90 degrees, cosine is zero. So we'd have zero output if the frequency is exactly the center frequency, 10.7 MHz. As that frequency moves up a little bit above 10.7 MHz, our phase shift is less. So that means that our output is going up. So this was 0 volts, and now it's a positive voltage as the frequency moved up a little bit. Conversely, if we go down in frequency, it goes more than 90 degrees, and more than 90 degrees will produce a negative output. So as the frequency goes down, this output is going lower in voltage below zero. And if all goes well, we will get an audio sine wave at the output, and that's what we're seeing here in this test. This is a 5 kilohertz output sine wave. So how do we design the circuits to do that? Let's take a look at the phase shift network. There are a number of ways to create these phase shift networks, but this is a very common one and the one we're going to use. The input signal comes into C1 from the IF amplifier, and then that goes into an LCR resonant circuit, and the output is taken across that. The amplitude response is shown in solid green, and of course it's a bandpass shape centered at 10.7 megahertz if we get the values right. The phase is the dotted curve, and 90 degrees is right about there, which is at 10.7 megahertz. And it does exactly what we said we wanted to do. It's linear in this range right here, which is enough given that our FM modulation is like plus and minus 75 kilohertz in an FM broadcast. Now, how do we design this? Well, we have an LCR resonant circuit. This R is primarily the input resistance of the mixer that we're using, which, as we saw in the last episode, since we're going to use a NE602 chip, is about 1.5 kΩ. The L and the C are selected using things we learned in episode 1 and 2 about bandpass filtering and Q. So we're not going to go over those details here. Instead, I've made some notes on analysis and design. And again, I recommend you freeze the video here and look at this and try to read these and understand these. I'll go over them real quick though. We're trying to do a parallel LCR resonant filter at 10.7 megahertz with a bandwidth, in this case, of about 400 kilohertz is what I chose. So that gives us a Q of 10.7 megahertz over 400 kilohertz, or about 27. Which means that the reactants of L1 and C1 are somewhere around 1.5 K divided by 27, which is about 56 ohms. So that's where these numbers basically come from. At the resonant frequency, remember that this L and this C resonate each other out and they look like an open circuit. So C1 at the center frequency only sees R1. And so we create a value here which is going to give us a reactance of about 1.5 kΩ. And that's how we came up with 10 picofarads. Beyond that, there are some subtleties. You have to include any capacitance which you see looking into the mixer, which is about 3 picofarads, not a biggie compared to 560. This 10 pico is also effectively in parallel with this 560. But this is such a high Q network that the exactness doesn't matter. In the end, you're going to need this to be a variable inductor, or this to be a variable capacitor. In addition to that, because the Q is 27, you've got to have a very good inductor up here as well. So I was unable to use a surface mount inductor because the only ones I had were like 0603 devices that had a maximum Q of 7, and that's not going to work. So I found in my box of junk an inductor right here that was going to work. It's big enough, and it's also adjustable. And so here is the final design for the DMOD. The input comes in over here on the left. Here is the phase shift network. Remember, the R is inside this chip. The inductor is that big guy that's variable with a tuning slug. And since it's an inductor and it's hanging on pin 1, we have to be careful because there's DC voltage biasing in this chip. We don't want to mess that up, so there's a AC bypass cap to ground here, basically creating an AC ground at this point, but preventing a DC ground that would upset the bias. So that's our phase shift network. The signal also comes into the other port of the mixer, unchanged from what it is at the IF amplifier output. So that's just the purpose of C2 here, to provide a DC block to keep from messing up the internal bias voltages, but let the signal go on in. C9 is a bypass on the power supply. There's a AC ground here at pin 2. Go back and look at the 602 datasheet we covered in the last video for that. And the output is taken primarily at pin 4. We can see that audio output labeled in the lower right as audio out left plus right channel. Now, in general, the signal is a stereo FM signal, but that requires more trouble than we want to go through here. We do have the ability to recover that information here at this output number 5 pin. But coming back to the primary output at pin 4, what is C6 doing? Well, C6 is a so-called de-emphasis cap. It's designed to create a 2.1 kHz roll-off in the audio response. And that's done because at the transmitter end, they pre-emphasize the high frequencies. Now, that's what it is in the U.S., 2.1 kHz corner. In other countries, it's a little bit different than that. But it'll sound fine regardless. So we have our audio output signal here, and we just AC couple it, DC block, out to our audio amplifier. So we built this one up on one of these little RF proto boards. These are like other stuff covered in previous videos. There's a ground plane below this, which makes it suitable for RF or IF circuits. And here it is in our testing. So how are we doing this test? Well, we have to mimic the IF output amplifier signal. And we're doing that with a tiny SA, tiny spectrum analyzer, which has the ability to generate some interesting signals. You have to change the mode setting on this unit to low out, so that this connector, instead of being the 0 to 350 megahertz input port for the spectrum analyzer, becomes a 0 to 350 megahertz output signal port. And we're feeding that into our DMOD. And we've set it at the strongest signal we can get, which is -7 dBm. If there's not a 50 ohm input load on this thing, which there isn't, then -7 is going to give us a few hundred millivolts, so that should be enough. It's centered at 10.7 megahertz, and it's got some modulation turned on. I measured it, it's about plus and minus 30 kilohertz. So not quite the full plus and minus 75 kilohertz you'd have for FM broadcast, but more than enough to do our testing. And what we get out is this nice sine wave. Now ignore the fact that it says 16.3 kilohertz. It is in fact 5 kilohertz, which you can confirm by noting that it's a 100 microsecond per division horizontal setting, and so we've got a period of about 200 microseconds, which is 5 kilohertz. This is an inexpensive scope, very nice, like 70 bucks or something, but you just have to ignore some of the readouts sometimes. The nice thing is we have a audio sine wave coming out. Also ignore the strange spikiness here. We're actually looking at the effectively unfiltered audio output, so there's some high frequency noise. And in addition to that, this tiny SA, what it does for modulation is it steps through frequencies. And so there's actually one frequency here, another one here, here. I don't know how many is that, 8 or 10, to create a sine wave. It doesn't have a smooth modulation. It's a piecewise linear kind of thing. But it is working. At least here it's working. It wasn't working the first time I turned it on. So like I said, for any complex engineering job, you're going to run into problems and you're going to have to do some debugging. Trying to remember some of the problems I had. I think when I first turned it on, I had no output. And of course, you know, your heart sinks at that point. But then you get busy and start trying to measure things and figure out what's going on. I didn't have any voltages on any of these pins, so I looked up here. It turns out that my VCC line was not actually well soldered. And I think I had some other issues as well, but a couple of fixes, and we got this. So it was time to assemble the full receiver and try it out. And here's the final assembly. Over on the right-hand side is the RF amplifier that we designed way back in episode 1, 2, somewhere around there. This is the DMOD, so I actually had to go from the RF amplifier over to the left-hand side, which is where the mixer is, and the mixer output has a 10.7 megahertz filter on it. I didn't do that at the end of the last episode, but I've added that as well as a matching network, and that's wired over to the input with these little tiny wires. Anyway, this is the IF amp. Did the same thing over here from the IF amp to the DMOD. And then the output from the DMOD is going into this jack, and I've got the left and the right pins just shorted together so that the signal feeds both the left and the right into this pair of powered speakers. For easy tuning, I'm using the tiny SA as the local oscillator going into the mixer in the down conversion. And I had to calculate what frequency to feed in. Remember, it needs to be like 10.7 megahertz below the frequency you're trying to receive. And the first signal I was trying to receive was at 96.3 because it's the strongest signal in our area. So I figured, let's start there. And lo and behold, it actually worked great. Let's take a listen.
It works.
And then I retuned it by recalculating a frequency, 92.8 megahertz, and that will get me 103.5 megahertz, and I got this. And that's kind of how I felt, like a champion getting this thing to work. So my project is working. There are improvements I could make, and one thing that I didn't do that we did in class is to add an audio amplifier and a speaker. I took the easy way out and just used an amplified speaker I already had. But for anyone interested, this is the audio amp that we often used in the course. It's a well-known LM386, very easy. Just put a potentiometer in. I've already got the DC block so that there's no problem with DC coming in here. The output does have to be AC coupled to the speaker. And there's an 8-ohm speaker here assumed. So there's this giant 250 microfarad capacitor you'll need. And finally, this weirdity here. What this does basically is at very high frequencies above audio, it puts a 10-ohm resistance to ground on the output because the speaker may go to a very high impedance. And if that happens, the LM386 is kind of unstable and you get a megahertz range oscillation going on. So this helps avoid that. And finally, a few words on other differences between what we've done here and what we did in the course. In the course, in the early days, we used a FM-IF subsystem, so we did not design our own IF amp and our own DMOD. Instead, we used this 16-pin chip. And the block diagram includes three cascaded IF amplifiers internal to the chip that then drive into, look, a quadrature detector and a quadrature network, pretty much like what we did. The only difference is that we had a capacitor here and they have an inductor here. And the final audio output shows up here. You do need a capacitor to ground to get that de-emphasis at about 2-point-something kilohertz. Later on in the datasheet, they show a complete FM-IF subsystem for high-quality receivers. Now, that LM3189 is not actually manufactured anymore. Here is a SA604. I think it used to be Signetics, now made by NXP Semiconductors. And if we take a quick look at that, we can see it's got a couple of IF stages in it with enough gain. And then there's a quadrature detector, which is basically a mixer. Of course, the trend in electronics is to integrate as much as possible. And that's often done by minimizing the analog circuits and putting everything in digital, which can be made very small and potentially low power. Notice there's no front-end filtering here at all. There's an LNA. It may have some filtering, but I highly doubt it, because we've done research in this area. And making inductors on chip, especially at these frequencies, is, shall we say, problematic. So what they do here is provide a little bit of amplification, and then they go directly into a mixer. And then they have what are called programmable gain amplifiers, which then feed into ADCs. So now we're in the digital realm, and all of the circuitry in this block right here is digital signal processing, and then they'll convert back to analog using some DACs at the output. Then you can go to your high power amplifier and your speakers. But there's a price to be paid for not using front-end filtering. That price is radio performance. The trouble is, very strong signals can create very large problems. So everything we covered in this course, especially in the early parts of it where we talked about filtering, is still very, very important. In fact, filtering and impedance matching and quality factor and oscillators, all of that is still critical in what's called the radio front end. The DMODs may vary, and yes, you can do some of those digitally now, but the rest of the radio is what we've been discussing in this series. So I hope you feel like you've learned something. If you haven't seen some of the other videos in the series, I would encourage you to go take a look at them. And I thank you very much for watching. And I hope you feel like it's been beneficial. Thanks.